Yes, hello friends, somebody please ping me if I am audible so that I can start the session. Yes guys, somebody please ping me if I am audible. Yes, good evening Jayashri. Good evening Satya. Good evening Anshu. Good evening, Kiruba. Good evening, Rituparna. Good evening, Yogesh. Yes, somebody please ping me if I'm audible so that I can start the session. Okay, thank you. Good evening, Ram Kumar. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform. Let's crack UPSC CSC English. Now, before I start the session, let me introduce myself for the people who are new on the platform. My name is Alok Ojha. I have done my engineering from Pune. I have been associated with the field of UPSC since past 7 years. I hold the experience of giving serious SSB twice. I also hold the experience of exams like CAPF Assistant Commandant and Uttar Pradesh PSC. I'm involved into the field of teaching since past 5 years and I've mentored more than 10,000 students for UPSC. Now, we are going to start with another important topic from which we can expect at least one question in the prelims exam. That is Viceroys of British India, Part 1. Now, before I start, let me talk about the platform. Like there might be a question in the mind of an aspirant why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. So here are the ample of reasons why one should prefer Unacademy as a platform for online learning. First of all, you'll have daily live classes on the Unacademy platform. Unacademy offers you assimilation of top and dynamic educators of India on a single platform. Unacademy helps to build up your competence by going through live tests and quizzes. All the courses on Unacademy platform are highly structured in nature and there is a proper timetable through which the courses are being conducted. One can have unlimited access to the courses on Unacademy platform. Here are the few top and dynamic educators of India from whom you are going to learn through. These are the courses being offered on the Unacademy platform. Subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Now there is also something called as Iconic Subscription. Now what is Iconic Subscription majorly about? Suppose you are a beginner. Now beginner usually faces lots of hindrances regarding the right timetable, right strategy, right resources, and so on. Like the preparation in the initial days completely goes in a haphazard manner. So, as per Iconic Subscription, there would be a mentor who would be guiding you throughout your journey for civil services preparation. Like he would be framing a right strategy for you guys, then proper answer writing techniques, how an optional needs to be chosen, how much time should be dedicated to current affairs, what all aspects should be read for the current affairs, and so on. So if you choose me as your mentor, please use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Good evening, Monisha. Good evening, Shipra. Good evening, Kasturi. Good evening, Gauri. Good evening, Jawahar. Good evening, Seema. Okay, now we are going to discuss a very dynamic topic, that is Viceroys of India from 1858 to 1947. Okay, now, yes guys, who was the first Governor General of Bengal? Yes, somebody please ping me. Good evening, Shashank. Who was the first Governor General of Bengal? Who was the first Governor General of India? And who was the last Governor General of India? Yes, please. Okay. Now let's get started with Lord Canning. Now, before I start with Lord Canning, let me tell you a few concepts so that you can easily understand the linkages. Just hold on for a second. So that you can easily understand the linkages. Okay. Now, it is said that basically around 1773, there were three major presidencies in India: Bombay, Bengal, and Madras. And each presidency had their respective governors. The governor of Bombay was designated as governor of Bombay. The governor of Madras was designated as governor of Madras. And the governor of Bengal was designated as governor general of Bengal. And governor of Bombay and Madras, okay, governor of Bombay and Madras were subordinated to the governor general of Bengal. Now, with the passage of time, Governor General of Bengal came to be designated as Governor General of India. And the first Governor General of India was Lord William Bentinck. Again, with the passage of time, Governor General of India came to be designated as Viceroy of India. So the last Governor General of India was Lord Canning. And the first Viceroy of India was Lord Canning. Okay. Now, it is said that revolt of 1857 took place during his tenure, and there are various causes for revolt of 1857. I'll discuss few of them. Okay. Now, it is said that at that time, there were three types of revenue settlement concerning the peasant. One was Zamindari, other was Rayatwari, and then was Mahalwari. I'll specifically speak about the Zamindari system. In Zamindari system, Zamindar acted as a middleman between the peasant on one side and the company on one side. Okay. Now, Zamindar company directly did not collect the revenue from the farmer. Zamindar collected the revenue from the farmer. He kept his commission, and then further he gave the money to the English East India Company. 89% of the revenue went to the company and 11% was kept by Zamindar. Now, it is said that peasants were dually exploited. For example, if the peasants are unable to pay the rent, their land would be confiscated by the Britishers. And in that case, peasants had grievances against the Britishers. Okay, first thing. Sometimes the peasant also had grievances against the Zamindar. Why? Apart from the original taxes, these Zamindar collected extra amount of money from the peasant. Now, peasant had an anger against the alien rule, against the British rule. And many a times it happens that many Zamindars, they also had a sort of grievances against the Britishers. Why? For example, if the peasant, if the farmer, if the cultivator is unable to pay the rent to the Zamindar, how will the Zamindar pay the rent to English East India Company? Sometimes then there can be a failure of monsoon and he is unable to pay the rent. So at that point of time, his zamindari rights were evicted and transferred to some other zamindar. So sometimes zamindar also had certain sort of grievances against the Britishers. Then there was a section of tribals. Britishers always followed a policy of interference for their own personal gains. For the tribals, their forest and the jungles are the sacred groves. They consider them as God. And Britishers were cutting down the forest. They were exploiting their forest basically for their own purpose. And in fact, the tribals were not given any produce of the forest as well. I'll give you a very small example. Munda revolt, which occurred in the Chota Nagpur Plateau region. Now, what is the revolt all about? Mundas are the tribe or are the tribals of Chota Nagpur Plateau. They follow the system of Khunt Katidar. Khunt Katidar basically means original clearer of forest. They believe that these forests are their gods. And now what did Britishers do? They started exploiting the forest. They started exploiting the resources in that region. Now what happened basically here? Now, the Mundas basically rose up against the alien rule. And now they pick up arms against the government under the leadership of Birsa Munda. And this event in the history of modern India is referred as Munda Revolt. So there were many other tribals who had all sorts of grievances against the alien rule, against the British rule. Now, basically there were certain section like various policies were also of the Britishers also created a sort of grievances among our Indian rulers. A small example. Prior to Lord Canning, the Governor General was Lord Dalhousie. And Lord Dalhousie had initiated one policy that is referred as Doctrine of Lapse. As per this policy, if any ruler does not have a legal male heir, his property would be confiscated by the Britishers. His kingdom would be confiscated by the Britishers. Adopted child will not be considered as a legal male heir. Okay? Hundreds of kingdoms were annexed under the pretext of Doctrine of Lapse. This simply exemplified pro-imperialism approach of the Britishers. So now these people also had grievances against the Britishers. Then basically it is said that at that time the number of members in the army were either Hindus or the Muslims majorly. Now Britishers introduced one rifle which is called as Royal Enfield rifle. Now Royal Enfield rifle had a cartridge and this cartridge needs to be bitten off with the teeth. Okay. Now this cartridge had a coating of the fat basically of pig and cow. Cow was sacred to Hindus and pig was taboo to the Muslim. Okay. Now basically the soldiers refused to accept the what we say Royal Enfield rifles. And there was a spurt in the mutiny that is referred as Revolt of 1857. This mutiny majorly covered the northern parts of India. An entire northern part of India was engulfed in the Revolt of 1857, which is also referred by many historians and the nationalists as First War of Independence. And this majorly occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. Then basically, it is said that after Revolt of 1857, the rule of company in India was liquidated. In very simple words, the rule of company in India was replaced by rule of crown in India. Okay? And crown was directly governing in India through Secretary of State. In very simple words, Secretary of State was an agent of the British crown. It represented the British crown. And Secretary of State was a member of the British Parliament. He was also a member of the British cabinet. So he represented the crown. So during the tenure of Viceroy Lord Canning, the rule of company was ended and was replaced by rule of crown in India. He is referred as last Governor General of India and the first Viceroy of India. Okay. Now it is said that after that there was a Queen's proclamation. Okay. Which is also called as Grand Darbar at Allahabad. And this occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. Then one of the most important acts, that is Indian Council Act, was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Indian Council Act 1861. Now let us understand the Indian Council Act 1861. Listen to me very carefully. Prior to this, please listen, I am going for a comparative analysis of 3 to 4 major acts. Regulating Act 1773, Fitz India Act 1784, Charter Act 1833 and Indian Council Act 1861. Let's go for a comparative analysis so that you can understand. As per Regulating Act 1773, Governor General will be having an executive council to assist him in performance of his duty. So Governor General had 4 members in his executive council as per Regulating Act 1773. Now came Pitt's India Act 1784. Now the number of members in the Governor General's Executive Council was reduced from 4 to 3. This occurred as per Pitt's India Act 1784. Now again, as per Charter Act 1833, Governor General's Executive Council was again increased from 3 to 4. Okay? As per 1773, it was 4. As per 1784, it was 3. As per 1833, it was again increased to 4. And finally, as per Indian Council Act 1861, Governor General Executive Council had 5 members. And the 5th member was a finance member. He used to advise the Governor General in financial matters. Okay? Then, for legislative purpose, that is for framing law, there was a provision of 6 to 12 additional member in the central executive. Okay? There would be 6 to 12 additional members in the central executive. Now listen to me. What is central executive? Let us understand. As per Government of India Act 1858, there was rule of company was replaced by rule of crown, and crown was represented by Secretary of State for India. Okay, actually replaced by Secretary of State for India. Now Secretary of State for India was assisted by 15 members. Getting the points clear? Now provision was made that 6 to 12 additional members should be added to that, what we say, executive council. And at least half of them should be non-official. What is non-official? Majorly Indians. Getting the points clear? And now these non-official members would be appointed by the Viceroy for a tenure of 2 years. Then, basically, if the Viceroy felt that if any bill is to be passed, and if that bill is affecting the safety, peace and interest of British India, that bill couldn't be passed. What is usually a rule basically? Bill needs to be passed by the members of the Imperial Legislative Council or the Provincial Legislative Council by consensus. That is on the basis of majority. But here, the power was completely in the hand of Viceroy and the Secretary of State. So if any bill has to be passed, and even if the members have passed the bill, finally, Viceroy can reject the bill by citing a reason that it is affecting the safety, peace and interest of the British India. Okay? Then he accorded statutory recognition to portfolio system. Portfolio system basically means placing various departments under particular officer or a minister. Like presently what we have education minister. We have health minister, we have transport minister, and so on. In very simple words, these are nothing but portfolios. So portfolios who are being designated. Okay, I had told you initially that Governor of Bombay and Madras were subordinated to Governor General of Bengal. Now, initially, all the rules and regulations that were framed by Governor General of Bengal, who was later designated as Governor General of India, later called as Viceroy of India, he was passing all the rules and regulation. And there was hardly any sort of independence for Governor of Bombay and Madras because they were subordinated to Bengal. Now they were given complete legislative powers. They had the right to frame their own rules and regulation. Okay? Then, there were establishment of new legislative council in Bengal, northwestern provinces and Punjab. Getting the points clear? And there was no distinction made between the central and provincial subject. Now central subjects were majorly of national importance and provincial subjects were majorly of local importance. But now these distinctions were majorly removed as per Indian Council Act 1861. But still certain subjects were reserved as a part of central subject because they were of national importance. Okay, so Indian Council Act 1861 was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Okay, now let's move further. Civil Services Act 1861 was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Okay, now I'll give you a small example. Suppose if any European who is coming to India as a civil servant, and there is another Indian who is working as a civil servant, who will be more aware about the grassroots realities in India? Obviously, the person who is from India, because he is quite aware about the social, political, economical and cultural aspects of the Indian society and the Indian political setup in comparison to that European. So, as per Civil Services Act 1861, any European or Indian, okay, whether he is appointed to any office in India basically. Okay, for example, if a person is chosen to work as a collector in the region of Karnataka. So in that case, he needs to know the language of that region. so that he can interact with the people at the grassroots level. And secondly, he should be a minimum resident. He should be have resided in India at least for 7 years so that he can be aware, or he is aware about the grassroots realities of India and can easily understand the problems facing Indian society. Okay. Now, certain offices were reserved for Britishers itself, like the higher post of district collector, superintendent of police were reserved for Europeans themselves, and Indians were included in the subordinate services. So this is majorly about Civil Services Act 1861, which was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Okay, so Indian Council Act 1861 was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Civil Services Act 1861 was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Then Indian High Courts Act 1861 was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Now, what is Indian High Courts Act 1861? Let us understand. Now, around 1773, as per Regulating Act 1773, listen to the concept. Supreme Court was established at Fort William in Calcutta. I repeat, as per Regulating Act 1773, Supreme Court was established. Okay, where? At Fort William in Calcutta. Now, it is said that basically the jurisdiction of Supreme Court, which was located in Bengal, Sadar Diwani Adalat, which is similar to civil court, and Fauzdari Adalat, okay, which is similar to criminal court, all the functions were subsumed by a high court, which was established at Calcutta. Okay, in very simple language, in very simple words, High Court at Calcutta was established, and High Court at Calcutta subsumed the functions which was performed by Supreme Court in Bengal, then Sadar Diwani Adalat, that is civil court, and Fauzdari Adalat, that is criminal court. Okay. Now, as per the act, the maximum number of judges can be 15. It should not surpass 15. And at least one should be Chief Justice. Okay. Then, at least 3 members. I'll give you a small example. For example, suppose there are 10 judges. Out of 10, at least 3, that is 1/3, should be coming from a coordinated civil services. That is, they should be from higher civil services and not the subordinate services. Like very simple words, I'll say you, these posts were majorly reserved for Europeans. Why? Because just a while back, I've told you one thing. Coordinated civil services were reserved for whom? They were reserved for the Britishers. They were reserved for the Europeans. So basically, if there are 10 judges, so at least 1/3, that is at least 3 judges would be from the coordinated civil services. That is the higher services. Okay, then basically it is said that high courts were established at Bombay, Calcutta and Madras. The first High Court was established at Calcutta in 1862. Then Shambhunath Pandit was the first Indian judge of the Calcutta High Court. Okay, I repeat, Shambhunath Pandit was the first Indian judge of Calcutta High Court. And who was the first, what we say, European judge of Calcutta High Court? Barnes Peacock. I repeat, Barnes Peacock was the first Indian judge of the Calcutta High Court. So in very, very simple words, Indian High Courts Act 1861 was passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. I repeat the points again. First thing, Indian High Courts Act 1861, Indian Civil Services Act 1861, Indian Council Act 1861, all these were passed during the tenure of Lord Canning. Then basically, Indian Penal Code 1862. To be very precise and specific, it is 1860. It came into force in 1860. Sorry, it was drafted in 1860. And finally, it came into force in 1862. Indian Penal Code. Okay. And basically, the genesis of Indian Penal Code goes to Lord Macaulay in 1830s. Listen to the concept. As per Charter Act 1833, Indian Law Commission was created. Please listen to the background. It will help you a lot. as per Charter Act 1833, okay, a Indian Law Commission was created. And this commission was created under Lord Macaulay. And the purpose for creation of this commission was codification of laws, so that laws could be coded in a very codified manner. I'll give you a very simple example. You might have heard about IPC section so and so. So such codification was given. Why? To make the law in a very simplified manner. For example, if somebody has done robbery, so robbery has been mentioned in IPC so and so section. And apart from that, what should be the punishment? That has been mentioned. If somebody is involved in a brutal crime, okay, so it has been mentioned in a particular section of the IPC. So in very simple words, codification of law started from the time of Lord Macaulay. But the final shape was given during the tenure of Lord Canning, which resulted in the form of Indian Penal Code 1862. It can be also referred as Indian Penal Code 1860. Okay. Now it is said that Lord Canning majorly focused upon reducing the military expenditure and civil expenditure. Now, why he wanted to reduce the military and civil expenditure? So that the money that is left can be used for development of the society, can be used for infrastructure development, which will lead to upliftment of underprivileged section of the society. And for this, he proposed an income tax. Laying was another officer who proposed an income tax of 5% on income of rupees 500. Okay. Now, for example, if a person is earning rupees 500, 5%, that is 25 rupees, needs to be paid as an income tax. And this was proposed by an officer named as Laying. And this occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. Okay. Salt levy was boosted. Certain tax was imposed on the salt, basically, during the tenure of Lord Canning. Then basically, Lord Canning introduced Bengal Tenancy Act to reform the relation between the landlords and the tenants. If you remember the Indigo Agitation of Bengal. Okay. So basically after that, Bengal Tenancy Act 1859 was passed. So all these things majorly occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. I'll repeat the points. He was the last Governor General and the first Viceroy of India. The rule of company was replaced by rule of crown during his tenure. Revolt of 1857 occurred during his tenure. Indian Council Act 1861 was passed during his tenure. High Courts Act 1861 was passed during his tenure. Penal Code 1862 was passed during his tenure. Indian Civil Services Act 1861 was passed during his tenure. And an income tax of 5% was proposed during his tenure. Okay, and Bengal Tenancy Act. Now, what is Bengal Tenancy Act basically? It was basically to strengthen the position of the farmer. If a farmer is unable to pay the rent, it does not mean that Britishers can directly confiscate their property. Okay, in that case, first of all, tenants cannot go for arbitrary raising the taxes. For example, they cannot raise the land revenue beyond a stipulated limit. Okay. And basically, ryots have the right to sublet their lands. Now, what is sublet? Suppose I am a peasant. I have to pay some sort of taxes to the government. Now, I can give some part of my land on lease to another farmer so that my tax burden can be shared. Okay. So basically, this is nothing but Bengal Tenancy Act 1859, which occurred during the tenure of basically Lord Canning. Okay. I'm going to come to all your question, guys. Hold on for a second. Yes, Himanshu. Yes, the cartridges actually had a coating. The cartridges actually had a coating of pig and cow because an inquiry committee was being conducted. And this inquiry committee was in basically Meerut. Okay, Himanshu. See, Government of India Act. Yes, Satya. Government of India Act was basically created in the British Parliament. And Indian Council Act was basically created by the Viceroys in India. Okay. Yes, Shashank, these were the three members majorly as a part of Viceroy's Executive Council. You are true, as per Indian Council Act 1861. Yes, Himanshu, Satya and Shashank, are your points clear? Please let me know. Yes, guys. Yes, please let me know. Now, let's talk about the tea mania, which occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. Now, what is tea mania all about? Okay, listen to me very carefully. Now, how did Britishers come to know about the tea? Let us understand this. Okay, and I've discussed about this in Diwan Maniram Dutt, if you remember, guys. Okay, now let us understand. Diwan Maniram Dutt, initially he was living in the region of Kannauj, which is in UP. Then he migrated to the region of Assam and started working with the English East India Company. And he was working along with the English East India Company. Now, once Diwan Maniram Dutt observed that Singapore tribe in the northeastern part of India was involved in the cultivation of tea. And now he called an English officer whose name was Sir Charles Bruce. Now, Sir Charles Bruce took certain samples of tea and he took the samples to the British Parliament and showcased this sample. After seeing this sample, it was decided that we can go for commercial cultivation of tea in India. Now, Britishers created basically what? Tea company in India. Okay? And who was made the head of it? Diwan Maniram Dutt. Now, Diwan Maniram Dutt closely observed the activities related to cultivation of tea. Okay? And now he decided that he is going to start commercial cultivation of tea in Assam for the first time, single-handedly, without any support of the British government. And this was not liked by the Britishers. So Diwan Maniram Dutt was also participant in the revolt of 1857 from the region of Assam. Now, during the tenure of Lord Canning, there was something called as tea mania. Now, what is tea mania? Now, in the northeastern parts of land, in the northeastern parts of India, there were certain lands which were referred as wasteland. But they were highly productive in nature. If there could be commercial cultivation of certain crops, this would give a higher yield. So now basically, these lands were sold at a very minimal rate to few cultivators. Like it is said that it was sold at a certain lands, not all the land. Certain lands were sold at 2.8 rupees to 5 rupees per acre. Can you imagine? 2.8 to 5 rupees per acre without any terms and condition, without any clearances being required. And on these land, commercial cultivation of tea was started. Plantation of tea was started in the region of Assam. And all these things occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. And this is referred as tea mania. Okay, so there could be a probable question that tea mania occurred during the tenure of whom? So it was during the tenure of Lord Canning. Now, in 1854, there was an education commission which was referred as Wood's Dispatch, which is also referred as, so it is referred as Wood's Dispatch because the entire draft was prepared by a member of Board of Revenue whose name was Sir Charles Wood. Now, Sir Charles Wood gave the suggestion that there should be creation of universities on the model of London University. And during the tenure of Lord Canning, three major universities were created on the, what we say, model of London University. And these were Bombay, Calcutta and Madras University. Doctrine of lab system, I have just discussed a while back, which was adopted by Dalhousie, was completely abolished. Now, Lord Canning was not that stringent ruler. He was not that strict ruler. That is why he is referred as Clemency Canning. Clemency means he had some sort of mercy. He was not that stringent and strict ruler. That is why he is referred as Clemency Canning. Yes, my friends, did you understand Lord Canning? Please let me know. It's okay, Himanshu. Did you understand about the Viceroy Lord Canning? Please let me know. Yes, guys. So, what all things you need to remember about the Lord Canning? Everything is clear? Now, let's go for Lord Elgin one. Only one thing you need to remember. See, Monisha, the first to introduce commercially, it is said that tea was started, the cultivation of tea started among the Singapore tribe of northeastern part of India. But for the first time, it was actually introduced by Diwan Maniram Dutt because he started the commercial cultivation of tea. Okay, Monisha? It's okay, Moni. Now, let's talk about Lord Elgin I. Now, only one thing you need to remember about Lord Elgin I, that is Wahhabi movement was suppressed during the tenure of Lord Elgin I. Now, what is Wahhabi movement? Let us understand. Around 1820s, around 1830s, around 1840s, there was a movement that was going on in India, which is referred as socio-religious transformation. It is also referred as Renaissance. Now, basically, it is said that Indian society was plagued by different social evils. Like there was prevalence of sati, child marriage. Then there were prevalence of female infanticide, human sacrifice system, and so on. So basically, many reformers cropped up in the region of Bengal specifically. And they tried to reform the Indian society. Because they believed that before we want to get rid of the alien rule, before we want to get rid of the British rule, we need to get rid of rudimentary thoughts and tradition. And that is why we need to cleanse up the society. And the movement was initiated majorly in the region of Bengal. That is why Indian Renaissance is also referred as Bengal Renaissance. It cannot be said that it was just confined to Bengal. The movement occurred throughout India, but was initiated from the region of Bengal. And many leaders played a very exemplary role. Examples: Rajaram Mohan Roy, Swami Dayanand Saraswati Ji, Swami Vivekanand. Then there were many social religious reformers in the region of South India, like Periyar, E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar, getting the points clear, and so on. And there were establishment of various samaj, that is like various samaj were established by Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, M.G. Ranade, Bal Shastri Jambekar, Pandita Ramabai, and so on. This was basically related to the transformation in the Hindu society. Similarly, the Muslim society also had certain evils, social evils, like the parda system. Okay, now, a movement was initiated during this time, which is referred as Wahhabi movement. Now, what is Wahhabi movement? Let us understand. Wahhabi movement was initiated by Shah Waliullah. I have discussed this in quite depth and detail in the chapter of Renaissance. Okay. Now, Wahhabi movement was initiated by Shah Waliullah, and it was propagated further by his follower, Sayyid Ahmad Barelvi. Now, initially, it was a religious reformation movement within the Muslim society itself. Now, basically, initially, its part was proper introspection of the Quran and Hadith. Now, what is Hadith? The teachings of Prophet Muhammad is called as Hadith. Whatever Prophet Muhammad has taught. So, proper interpretation of that is referred as Wahhabi movement. So initially it started as a religious reform movement, but with the passage of time, what happened? It was directed against the Britishers. Why? Because in 1813, what had happened? Britishers had introduced one act, which is called, as per this act, basically Christians were allowed to preach Christianity in India, but later on they started forceful conversion into Christianity. So many Hindus were converted into Christianity. Many Muslims were converted into Christianity because certain laws were brought up. For example, If a person is not ready to get converted into Christianity, he would not inherit his ancestral property. Okay? So, Wahhabi movement initially was a religious reform movement in the Muslim society, but later it was directed against the Englishmen, against the Britishers. And this occurred during the tenure of Lord Elgin I, and it was suppressed by the Britishers. Okay? So, this is majorly about the what we say, Lord Elgin I. Yes, my friends, did you understand Lord Elgin I? Please let me know. Yes, Satya, initially against the Sikh, then later against the Britishers. Yes, you are true. Yes, Satya, very perfect. Patna was the storm center of the revolt. Okay, guys, please let me know, did you understood till here? Yes, it is Sir Lord John Lawrence, 1864 to 63. It's actually 63 to 64. Okay, the things are just the number has been reversed. Okay, now let's understand about Sir John Lawrence. Now let us understand this. Now, do you remember about John Lawrence? Any idea about John Lawrence? Please let me know. Have I discussed prior to this John Lawrence or Henry Lawrence? Yes, please let me know. I have discussed this in Second Anglo-Sikh War, if you remember. Let me go to the genesis of this. Let us understand this. Now, listen to me. Now, what is the role of the third Viceroy of India? That is Sir Lord John Lawrence. Now, he played a very exemplary role during the Second Anglo-Sikh War. Prior to this, let us understand about the Anglo-Sikh War. Now, Maharaja Ranjit Singh, okay, he was the ruler of Sikh territories. Now, Maharaja Ranjit Singh was ruling to the north of River Satluj. And now he had the intention to cross the River Satluj and capture the territories to the south of River Satluj. Now, what happened basically, the territories to the south of River Satluj were British Indian territories. And basically, this was not expected from what we say Maharaja Ranjit Singh. So, there was a clash between Maharaja Ranjit Singh and Britishers. This led to the signing of a treaty, which is called as Treaty of Amritsar. Okay. As per this treaty, south of River Satluj belonged to the British Indian Territory. North of River Satluj belonged to Maharaja Ranjit Singh. And the region of Kashmir, Peshawar also belonged to Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Okay. Now, one British resident was placed in the court at Lahore. Getting the points clear? Now listen to me. One British resident was placed in the region of Amritsar and Lahore. Now what happened? Britishers were closely observing the activities of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Now Maharaja Ranjit Singh started fortification along the banks of River Satluj. So Britishers started doubting the intention of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Okay? Now what happened basically? By now, before this, okay, there was death of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Okay? And now Maharaja Duleep Singh was ruling. Maharaja Duleep Singh was son of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. And now they started expanding their territories to the south of River Satluj. And as I have told you previously, the territories to the south of River Satluj belonged to whom? It belonged to the Britishers. Now there was a battle, and in that battle, a treaty was signed, which is referred as Lahore Treaty. This was first Anglo-Sikh War. And Lahore Treaty was signed between the Britishers, that is English East India Company, and Maharaja Duleep Singh. Maharaja Duleep Singh was the son of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Getting the points clear? And he was 7 years old. As per this treaty, the region south of River Satluj belonged to the British India. Okay? Secondly, Sikh had to pay a war indemnity of rupees 1.5 crore to the Britishers. And Britishers said that we are only going to interact with three people. And who are these? First is Maharaja Duleep Singh, whom we consider as the king. Then we consider Maharani or Rani Jind Kaur, who we consider as a regent. Regent means Raj Pratinidhi. Then Lal Singh as Wazir. Okay. And one person was placed in Lahore as a British resident who is going to observe the activity of the Sikh ruler. And that person was Sir John Lawrence, or Sir Henry Lawrence can also be called. Now he was taking care of the administration in the region of Punjab. Okay. Now what happened? He became ill due to certain reason, and now he had to go back to London to cure for his illness. Now he placed another person in the court at Lahore, and this person was named as Frederick Curie. Now what happened? There was one Diwan, there was one minister in the region of Multan. He had not paid taxes for many years. Now Frederick Curie sent an army and asked him to pay the taxes. But these soldiers were being killed by this Diwan. Now Britishers were hell-bent, and now Britishers crushed the civil. Now Britishers crushed basically the revolt against the Sikh. Okay. And they crushed the Sikh kingdom. And this is referred as Second Anglo-Sikh War. Getting the points clear? So during Second Anglo-Sikh War, Sir John Lawrence or Henry Lawrence was not the Viceroy, but still he was responsible for administration of Punjab. Later on, when he became the Viceroy in the Punjab, he is referred as Savior of Punjab because he carried out many reforms in the region of Punjab. Okay, like he abolished the internal duties, like for internal trade within the region of Punjab. Okay, the taxation system was reduced. This can boost up the trade and economy in the region of Punjab. Common currency and postal system was introduced. So he is referred as Savior of Punjab. Okay. Now, he was very cautious in dealing with Afghanistan and Persia. But let us understand about Afghanistan. Did you get the point still here? Please let me know. Yes, guys, did you understand the point still here? Okay, now I'll go into a bit background with Lord Auckland so that you can understand the point. First Anglo-Afghan War occurred during the tenure of Lord Auckland. Please listen to the concept very clearly so that you can co-link the activities. Okay, now Durrani dynasty was founded in Afghanistan by Ahmad Shah Abdali. Now Ahmad Shah Abdali had a rival whose name was Dost Muhammad. Now Dost Muhammad overthrew the rule of Ahmad Shah Abdali, and now he became the ruler of Durrani dynasty in Afghanistan. Okay, listen to me very carefully. In Afghanistan, now what happened? This Dost Muhammad wanted to capture the regions of what we say, Kashmir, Peshawar. But the regions of Kashmir and Peshawar were under whom? They were under Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Okay. Now he tried to acquire these territories, but he was not successful. Now Dost Muhammad thought that until and unless I gain any help from the Britishers, I cannot gain the region from the Sikh Empire. So now, at that time, the Governor General was Lord Auckland. So Dost Muhammad visited Lord Auckland and said that, please help me against the Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Okay, I have talked this previously also about this. Please help me against Maharaja Ranjit Singh. But Dost Muhammad, but what we say, Britishers said that Maharaja Ranjit Singh is our friend. We are not going to help you out. Okay, and they put one condition in front of Dost Muhammad. And what was that condition? You break all the ties with Russia. Okay. I will break all the ties with Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Because why? Try and understand the concept. Russia was a friend of Dost Muhammad. And Russia was also following an expansionist policy. It was also trying to acquire more and more kingdoms and territories. And Russia was enemy of Britain. So what did Dost Muhammad said to Lord Auckland? That break friendship with Ranjit Singh. And what did Lord Auckland said? Break friendship with Russia. This was not accepted by Dost Mohammad. So now basically, there was an agreement between Maharaja Ranjit Singh, Lord Auckland, and another person from Afghanistan whose name was Shah Shuja. And he was placed in the region of Afghanistan. And the rule of Dost Mohammad was overthrown. And Dost Mohammad was brought in the brought to Calcutta jail in India. And after that, there was outbreak of civil rebellion in Afghanistan. So again, Dost Mohammad was released. This event in the history of modern India is referred as First Anglo-Afghan War. And this occurred during the basically the Governor Generalship of Lord Auckland. Now, what happened during the tenure of Sir John Lawrence? Let us understand. Now, Dost Mohammad had three sons. Listen to me. He had three sons. Okay. One was Sher Ali, other was Afzal, and third was Azum. I repeat, Sher Ali, Afzal, and Azum. Now, Sir John Lawrence, initially, he did a small mistake. And what was that mistake? He said that we are recognizing Amir of Afghanistan or ruler of Afghanistan as Sher Ali. But there were two more contenders, that is brothers of Sher Ali, that is Afzal and Azum. Now Afzal and Azum started a small rebellion, a civil revolt in Afghanistan. And they acquired maximum number of territories in the region of Afghanistan. Now Sir John Lawrence became cautious. He said that we do not want to maintain any bad sort of relations with Afghanistan. So it is better we do not interfere in the politics of Afghanistan. So he decided that although we have recognized Sher Ali, okay, but we are not going to interfere with the politics in Afghanistan. We will leave them alone to decide their own quarrels. Okay, so this occurred during the tenure of whom? This occurred during the tenure of Sir John Lawrence. Yes, Himanshu, to an extent you are correct. Okay, Himanshu. Basically, it was fought with the Sikh itself. Why? Because that Diwan was supported by the Sikh ruler. And he instigated. Diwan played the cause for spurting up the Second Anglo-Sikh War. But that Diwan was supported by whom? The Sikh rulers. Getting the points clear? The name of the Diwan was Mool Raj. I repeat, the name of the Diwan was Mool Raj. Yes, Himanshu, are the points clear? Yes, please let me know. Now let's talk about Bhutan War. Now listen to me. Now, Britishers wanted to acquire the region of Bhutan. Why? Now listen to me very carefully. Initially, we have discussed about Anglo-Burma War during the tenure of Lord Amherst. Now what happened? Burma was initially trying to capture the region of northeastern part of India and the region of Bengal. Now what happened here? Burma and the region of Bengal. Now what happened here? Listen to the concept. Now, basically, Burma was defeated and the region of certain regions of Burma was captured. Certain regions of northeastern part of, lower part of northeastern India was captured. Now, Bhutan was constantly trying to capture the region of Assam, Bengal and northeastern part of India. Now, Britishers altogether wanted to, what we say, end this policy which was initiated by the Bhutan. Now, previous to this, there was a Governor General, there was a Viceroy whose name was Lord Elgin. Now, Lord Elgin sent another person called as Ashley to a sort of a war, a small skirmishes was held with the Bhutan army. Now, what did Bhutan army did? Now, Bhutan army defeated Ashley and basically a treaty was signed. Britishers were forced to sign the treaty where Britishers had to surrender the alluvial plains in the northeastern part of India. That is, they had to surrender upper part of the northeastern part of India. Now, Britishers, by this treaty, it was a very heavy loss to the Britishers now. Why? because certain tea cultivation was also done in the region of Assam. Now, Britishers repudiated this treaty. They did not follow this treaty. And again, they attacked what we say, Bhutan. After basically initial setback, with a very heavy setback, they finally defeated Bhutan and they captured the region of Bhutan as well. Okay. And finally, the threat of Bhutan to British India was ended. And a treaty was signed, which is referred as Treaty of Sinchula. I repeat, a treaty was signed, which is referred as Treaty of Sinchula. Now, Bhutan ceded Assam, Bengal and certain areas in the region of Bhutan, approximately around 80,000 square kilometers to British India. And they also, what we say, accepted that we are going to pay you an annual subsidy of 50,000 rupees every year. Okay. We have discussed about the various famine commissions, and in that famine commissions, we have discussed one important aspect, that one famine occurred in the region of Odisha. And to study the causes of that famine, a committee was appointed under the chairmanship of Henry Campbell. And that committee was referred as Campbell Committee. And Campbell Committee was appointed during the tenure of Lord John Lawrence. Then submarine telegraphy system was started. Okay. To connect India and Europe via the Persian Gulf. And this occurred during the tenure of Lord Canning. Okay. Basically, Brett's brother were involved in it. Basically, sir, just remember this. Submarine telegraphy system was started. Okay. And Punjab and Oudh Tenancy Act was passed during his tenure. We have discussed this in Peasant Revolts. So, these are the major things that occurred during the tenure of Lord John Lawrence. My friends, did you get the concept? Please let me know. Yes, guys, please let me know. Did you get the concept? Yes. Okay. Today also, I'm going to go for a small quiz, guys. Okay. Now, let's understand Lord Mayo. Now, he is also known for masterly inactivity. Now, what is masterly inactivity? Now, we are not going to interfere with the internal administration of any other ruler, because this can affect our political position in India. Like we have observed, Lord Auckland tried to interfere with Dost Muhammad. This resulted in First Anglo-Afghan War. Now, Sir John Lawrence, he followed a policy of neutrality, that it is a dispute among these rulers itself, and we are not going to interfere because it will affect our own political gains. That is why Lord Mayo also followed the policy of masterly inactivity. Okay. Now, he welcomed Sher Ali, that is Amin of Afghanistan, and held a Darbar in his honor so that he can have a cordial relations with Afghanistan. Now, you might think why British India was majorly interested in having a cordial relation with Afghanistan. Afghanistan was a cradle of great game between Russia and British India. And now Afghanistan, basically Russia wanted to conquer Afghanistan. This simply exemplified one thing. Russia was also following pro-imperialism approach. But once if Afghanistan has cordial relations with British India, it can have a watch on the activities of Russia. Getting the points clear? That is why British India was interested in maintaining cordial and good relations with Russia. Okay. Mayo College was started at Ajmer in Rajasthan for young Rajput princes. And this was started during the tenure of Lord Mayo. Okay. First census in a proper manner was initiated on Mayo's order. And it occurred in 1871. Actually, the proper system of census was started from 1882. Like he started Statistical Survey of India under William Wilson Hunter. If you go to the genesis, please listen to the concept. If you go to the genesis of census, there have been certain census conducted during 800 to 600 BC. That is during the later Vedic period. Census was also conducted during the Mauryan period, which is also mentioned in Kautilya's Arthashastra. If you remember, during the Mauryan period, a special census officer was appointed. For example, he was referred as Nagarika. And not only basically, people were counted. In fact, the animals were also counted so that proper tax can be levied. Getting the points clear? So there was a proper system of census, which is also mentioned in Kautilya's Arthashastra. Then during the tenure of a Mughal emperor Akbar, there was one book written which is referred as Ain-e-Akbari. I repeat, Ain-e-Akbari. And in that book, a proper census system has also been mentioned. But properly during the British rule, census started during the tenure of Viceroy Lord Mayo. And Statistical Survey of India also played a very major role in that. Properly, the census started from 1882. But the process began from 1871 itself. Okay. Now he set up various departments for revenue, agriculture and commerce so that there can be development of these departments. He initiated infrastructure projects. He started the development of infrastructure. Like, he majorly emphasized on road, railways and canals. Now, why he emphasized on roads, railways, canals and transportation system? Let us understand this, and I have discussed this in the various Famine Commission. Florence Nightingale, he had given one statement basically. And what was that statement? The basic causes of famine in India was lack of transportation system. I'll give you a very small example. Suppose if there is a small famine or any disaster like flood in the region of Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, Delhi. So can that impact be quite huge? Yes, economically, it will affect the life of people. But it can be mitigated. Why? Because these cities are in a very effective manner, they are connected by airways, roadways, railways. Getting the points clear? So basically, if there is a proper transportation facility, if there is a proper infrastructural development, we can come out of any disaster situation. Okay. So that is why Lord Mayo also focused on development of infrastructure. Then state control of public works. Getting the points clear? Like railways, it should be controlled by the government. Roadways, it should be controlled by the government, because government is going to take the responsibility for them. Getting the points clear? Agriculture, entire department should be controlled by the government. Indian Evidence Act 1872 was passed during the tenure of Lord Mayo. Now, what is Indian Evidence Act 1872? Prior to the passage of this act, Hindus were governed according to their own traditions, according to their own custom. Muslims were governed according to their own traditions, own customs. Okay. But now, as per this act, the anomaly was completely removed. Now, everybody was similar in the eyes of law. Everybody was similar in the front of law. And standardized system of law came as per Indian Evidence Act 1872. Okay. And this occurred during the tenure of Lord Mayo. Now, Lord Mayo is also, he took keen interest in the prison reforms. Okay. He took keen interest in the prison reforms. And like, he decided to reform the prison in the Andaman Islands. Like, majorly, if any person was involved in major crime, he was given the punishment of Kala Pani and he was sent to Andaman Islands basically. Now, when he went to Andaman Islands to introspect the situation of the prisoners there, he came up with very good reforms there. Like, he took interest in improving the sanitary conditions there. He took interest in basically sensitizing the prisoners. Getting the points clear? So basically, he took lots of reform for the prison. But he was assassinated by a person called as Sher Ali Afridi or Sher Ali Khan in the prison. Now let's understand how he assassinated this. Listen to me. Now this person, Sher Ali Afridi or Sher Ali Khan, he was from the region of Peshawar. And now he had always been loyal to the British Indian Army, and he had worked initially for the English East India Company and Britishers at many places. Like, he had worked in Peshawar, he had worked in Awadh, he had worked in Rohilkhand. Then he had worked at many places and along with many British officers. But once upon a time, it is said that there was a family dispute in the life of Sher Ali Afridi. And Sher Ali Afridi killed one of his relatives whose name was Haider. And a trial was conducted against Sher Ali Afridi. And in this trial, Sher Ali Afridi was given the death sentence. Okay. But basically it is said that there was one judge who commuted his death sentence into life imprisonment. And the reason for commuting his death sentence into life imprisonment was he had served loyally to for the British company since many years. That is why his death sentence was commuted into life imprisonment. And that judge was Colonel Pollock. I repeat, Colonel Pollock. And then he was sent to Kalapani, that is in Andaman and Nicobar Island. Now, this person, Lord Mayo, visited Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and basically it is said that he tried to analyze the entire situation in jail. And now, he had the plan. Sher Ali Afridi, Sher Ali Khan had the plan to assassinate the Viceroy. Now, why he wanted to assassinate the Viceroy? He believed that Viceroy was responsible for this condition. Now, he believed that he had served loyally towards the company for many years and he didn't deserve this sort of punishment. Okay, he did not deserve this sort of punishment. Now, what happened basically? Once upon a time, this person, Lord Mayo, was coming out of the prison. And in fact, Lady Mayo was also standing outside the prison and she was awaiting the visit of Lord Mayo. Now, inside the prison, Sher Ali Afridi was roaming. And once he saw an opportunity that there are no bodyguards along with Lord Mayo, he stabbed Lord Mayo in the stomach. Okay. And it is said that he stabbed it and immediately few of the bodyguards came and pulled him back. But he succumbed to so much bleeding that he died on the spot. And this entire event occurred near Mount Harriet. Mount Harriet is located in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay. So, Lord Mayo was assassinated by Sher Ali Afridi or Sher Ali Khan. Getting the points clear? And this occurred basically during the tenure of Lord Mayo. My friends, did you understand the important Governor Generals? Please let me know. Was the story interesting? Yes, Prerna, I would be sharing that. Yes, Jayashri, I will do that. Yes, we'll go for a small quiz, guys. Okay. Just a small quiz. Of 5 minutes. Hold on for a few seconds. Just hold on for a few seconds, guys. Just few seconds so that I can start the quiz. Yes, guys, just wait for a few seconds. Just few seconds, please. Yes, guys, please join the quiz. Please use the code 022987. I repeat, the code 022987. Is the code visible, guys? Please let me know. 022987. Yes, guys, please join the quiz and use the code 022987. Yes, please join as fast as possible. Use the code which is flashing on your screen. 022987. Yes, guys, please join as fast as possible. Open this quiz in the Unacademy Learning app. Okay, join the quiz by using the code 022987. Okay. Okay, I'll start the quiz, guys. Consider the following pairs of the founders and institute established by them. Badruddin Tayabji, founder of Pune Sarvajanik Sabha. Rajaram Mohan Roy, founder of Vedant College. Narayan Malhar Joshi, founder of Social Service League. Which of the following pairs are correctly matched? My friends, if you have studied Renesa properly, we have discussed each and everything. Okay. You will very easily answer this question. Yes, guys. P is the correct answer, and 67%, as it is depicted, have given the correct answer for this. Which of the following are correct with reference to various features of Brahmo Samaj? Okay. It upheld polytheism and idol worship but discarded faith in incarnation. It took no definite stand on doctrine of karma and transmigration of soul. It criticized caste system. Yes. Which statement is correct? Yes, a very easy one, guys. We have discussed this in Brahmo Samaj. P is the answer. And very few students have given the correct answer for this. With reference to Indian National Movement, consider the following statement about Justice Party. In a very systematic format, we have studied about this. Yes. Yes, guys. Few seconds left. Please boggle up your minds. Yes. Okay. Which among the following can be understood as overall contribution of Brahmo Samaj to socio-religious reform movements? Yes. We have studied all the statement. Yes, guys, please. 5 seconds left. P is the correct answer. यस, सत्य शोधक समाज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड, यस, आई गिव यू अ स्मॉल हिंट, ज्योतिबा फुले, अ मूवमेंट फॉर अपलिफ्टमेंट ऑफ ट्राइबल्स इन बिहार, अ टेंपल एंट्री मूवमेंट इन गुजरात, एन एंटी कास्ट मूवमेंट इन महाराष्ट्र, अ पीजेंट मूवमेंट इन पंजाब. यस गाइस, एन इजी वन. यस, परफेक्ट. 88% ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स हैव गिवन करेक्ट आंसर फॉर दिस. वेरी गुड गाइस. विच केशव चंद्र सेन इज एसोसिएटेड विथ एस्टैब्लिशमेंट ऑफ विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग. वी हैव डिस्कस दिस इन क्वाइट डेप्थ एंड डिटेल. राजा राम मोहन रॉय, केशव चंद्र सेन एंड देवेंद्र नाथ टेगोर. Please read it properly. All the organizations we have discussed, guys. Yes, B is the correct answer. Yes, guys, next question. Which of the following statements are correct about Madan Mohan Malviya? Yes. Read it patiently. Yes, guys. Yes, C is the correct answer. Next question. Consider the following pair. All India Untouchability League, All India Kisan Sabha, Self-Respect Movement. All of them we have studied in quite depth and detail. Which of them are correctly matched? Yes, few seconds left, guys. 5 seconds left. Yes, 67% have given the correct answer. Yes, the ninth one. Consider the following in context of Brahmo Samaj. Denounced polytheism and idol worship, discarded faith in divine avatars. Yes, this question is repeated quite ample of times. Yes, and the last question, guys. Which of the following was objective behind establishment of Satya Shodhak Samaj by Jyotiba Phule? Yes, an easy one. We have studied this in quite depth and detail. Yes, few seconds left. Yes, 63% of the students have given correct answer for this. Okay, guys. Yes, Himanshu, actually I have completed a session of Indus Valley Civilization on special class. Okay, I have completed this as a part of special class. Yes, guys. Yes, thanks a lot, everyone. Yes, so tomorrow again, I'm going to come up with Viceroy part 2. Okay, same timing, 7 p.m. Yes, guys, please do subscribe to Unacademy and use my code AKOUS. See, guys, there could be an expected, what we say, fees hike. So please enroll and take the subscription as fast as possible. And please do use my code AKOUS. I repeat the code AKOUS. Thanks a lot, guys. Thank you.